like to call this hearing of the House Consumer Protection Technology and Utility Committee, Utilities Committee to order. Bill, please take the roll.
Matzy.
Present.
Borowski.
Here.
Burgos.
Leave.
Cephas.
Leave.
Cerisi.
Leave.
Here.
Oh, he's on Teams. Thanks for joining us, Joe.
Gergely.
Here.
Malagari is on Teams.
Here.
Markosik.
Here.
Mullins.
Leave.
Monroe. Piscitano.
Here.
Steele.
Present.
Marshall.
He'll be here shortly.
Hogan. Mahaffey.
Here.
Mihalik.
Leave.
Miller.
Here.
Rinkavich.
Leave.
Tomlinson. On
here.
Virtual. Warner. Williams.
Here.
A quorum is present.
Thank you. The purpose of this informational meeting is an overview and Q&A with PJM Interconnection. For those that aren't familiar with PJM, they are the regional transmission organization that coordinates the movement of wholesale electricity for Pennsylvania and in all or parts of 12 other states and the District of Columbia. Today, we will be hearing from Mr. Awesome Hack from the PJM. You may join us at the table and begin with your presentation. He is the Vice President of State and Member Services at PJM. He will be speaking to his submitted testimony and has agreed to participate in Q&A with our members at the conclusion. I'd ask the members to please hold any questions until he has had the opportunity to present his testimony. Welcome. We appreciate you making the time for the committee here today, and we look forward to your testimony. You may begin when you are ready.
Thank you, Chairman Matzy. Thanks to Chair Marshall as well. Thanks to all of the members of the committee. My name is Awesome Hock. I am the Vice President of State and Member Services at PJM Interconnection. PJM Interconnection is, in fact, as Chair Matzy represented, the grid operator for 13 states in the District of Columbia, including the entirety of the state of Pennsylvania. We submitted testimony. It is rather lengthy. It's about 14 pages. I will certainly not read it, and we will not cover word for word everything that's in the testimony, but I will refer to the testimony. I think for ease, there are some figures and some graphics that can sort of help illustrate some of what I'd like to talk to you about. So this testimony will really consist of a couple of pieces here. We will do an introduction of PJM Interconnection, sort of what do we do, who are we, how are we situated in electricity generation and delivery. We'll talk about sort of the current, primarily the reliability landscape and how that intersects with clean energy. So we'll spend some time talking about sort of that policy arena. The last thing we'll do is talk about some solutions to some of the issues that we're seeing today with that evolving policy landscape. So who is PJM Interconnection? I think the easiest thing to do, if you've got your testimony, is to turn to page 3, figure number 2. So PJM Interconnection is part of this great machine of electricity generation and eventually delivery to consumers. Now, if you look at figure 2, there's really 3 primary components of power delivery. There's the generation of a watt, and that watt can be generated from any number of types of resources: coal, nuclear, natural gas, renewables. That watt is then moved through a high voltage transmission system. That watt then finds its way to a distribution substation where the distribution utilities in your state, regulated by the PA, PUC, or municipals and co-ops, take the watt and then move that watt to residential consumers and businesses. Where PJM exists is in the generation of the watt and the high voltage transmission of the watt. That is generally referred to as the bulk electric system. That's where PJM effectively oversees the planning and operation of that bulk grid for 13 states and the District of Columbia. If we move backwards to page 2 and figure 1, you'll see a map of the U.S. So the power grid, the bulk system, really is considered the world's largest machine. And in the United States, it's actually three distinct machines. You've got the Eastern Interconnect, and if you see on this diagram, it's outlined in light blue. You've got the Western Interconnect, and you have Texas. Texas is effectively isolated from the rest of the power grid in the country. That created some real challenges for Texas, if you recall, with Winter Storm Uri, where they were unable to effectively import power when they were experiencing power shortages because they are disconnected from the rest of the country. PJM is situated in the Eastern Interconnection, and PJM, we have or oversee roughly 88,000 miles of transmission lines and approximately 1,400 generation resources, both from a planning and a markets perspective. We are the largest grid operator, depending on both the volume that we see in our markets as well as purely those statistics that I cited. We are the largest grid operator in the country. Now, if we turn back to page 3 and look at figure 3. So why have an entity like PJM? And in fact, there are 9 of us in North America. Why have an entity like PJM? And it's really primarily because the grid is, and the high voltage transmission system, is this interstate large machine. And through the use of the ability to have scale with that machine, and what I mean by scale is, you know, rather than an individual territory planning for its high voltage transmission system, effectively planning to have that high voltage transmission system extend across multiple states, because electrons don't know state boundaries, extend across multiple states, and the ability to socialize costs across 65 million consumers, associated businesses, creates value. So within our value structure, the ability to utilize scale, and also something we haven't talked about, which is competition. So competition for the build-out of transmission, competition in electricity markets creates a tremendous amount of value. We estimate that value to be $3.2 to $4 billion to consumers in our footprint through, again, the use of regional scale. One other factoid about PJM, and then we'll start talking about really policy. You know, PJM is a mission-driven organization. So PJM is effectively a nonprofit. We are a regulated public utility, but we are not a public utility in the same way that you might think of other public utilities in the state. We are a regulated public utility by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, and all of these RTOs, like ours, Regional Transmission Organization, has been given the ability to operate the system through Congress and through the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. We are regulated, but our system of rate recovery is effectively filed rates with the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. If we come in, our budget is determined effectively annually and submitted. If we come in under budget, effectively that money returns back to the membership and into consumer pockets. We do not have shareholders. We are not publicly traded. I don't have to be concerned about quarterly earnings and how my shareholders feel about a stock price. And so it gives us the ability to be mission-driven, and that mission is effectively preserve reliability and try and provide value, dollar value, to consumers through the use of our regional scale. So, as I appear before you today, and this is the sort of the end of the background of PJM, and I provide you with sort of a here's what's going on with the policy landscape, I don't have a profit motive. I'm just here to talk about what we're going to need to continue to preserve reliability of the power grid on a going forward basis and how we can continue to provide benefit to consumers. So let's talk about policy. Let's begin with, we go to page 4 in your, in the testimony that we submitted. Let's just begin with reliability. What is reliability? I think simplistically, you know, when a consumer or a business flips the switch, you want for the lights to turn on. I'm a lawyer by training. I used to lawyer for an auto manufacturer outside of Columbus, Ohio, and, you know, very heavily electricity dependent. If you had blips in your power delivery, could impact the actual assembly of the car, could impact the business, could impact jobs, impacts communities. So when we think about reliability, we really think about, you know, when you flip the switch, do the lights turn on? I mean, I think that's the sort of core piece. But let's analyze this a little more technically. And so when we think about reliability, we really define it in 4 basic building blocks that all comprise reliability. Let's think about the concepts of supply and demand. Okay, so the first building block is having adequate supply. Do we have enough watts? We actually have enough watts to deliver to consumers. And then when we think about demand, we need accurate forecasting. Because what PJM does is it effectively runs markets. We have a number of markets. Some are very long-term, three-year forward-looking we have a three-year forward-looking market. We also have markets that are effectively operating in real time. So we need to be able to accurately represent what the demand is on the system. It's another building block to reliability. And then you'll hear, again, me talk about transmission. You need a really robust transmission grid. That is, you know, one of our, not only one of our core business functions, but, you know, something that we think we need in order to continue to preserve reliability and reliable operations. If you haven't had the opportunity, I'd really welcome you to the PJM campus. It's not terribly far away. It's in Valley Forge. And what you'll be able to see there if you go there is what is effectively a control room where our operators of the grid are effectively matching supply and demand in real time, navigating the watt from the generating unit all the way to the distribution substation. Sometimes there are outages and the watt has to go up and down. I'm clearly not an operator. They don't let me in the room. Afraid I'll push all the buttons. But I do welcome you to sort of see that in practice, that operation of the grid in practice. It's really something to behold. They're really highly certified technicians that are doing this work on a day-to-day basis. So those are the 4 building blocks of reliability: supply, demand, robust transmission, reliable operations. If you go to the next slide, or excuse me, if you go to the next page, which will be figure 5, what you'll see is that everything we do serves to ensure reliability. And we really have 3 core business functions, and you've already heard me talk about all 3 of these. We've got markets, which is a, you know, multi-day seminar in and of itself. Again, we've got longer-term markets, shorter-term markets, again, trying to derive value for consumers through competition. We've got, again, operations, which I sort of described in the control room, and regional planning. We do a 15-year outlook on the transmission grid. Think about it from the context of, think about it if you're an urban planner and you know where sort of demand is increasing within a neighborhood or within a city. You've got to effectively plan the transmission grid to kind of meet those needs of where generating resources are going and where your demand is. So we do that component as well, all of which serve to support this concept of reliability. All right, now we are going to get deeper into the policy space. So the grid is transforming. So we are seeing on the grid a number of renewable resources that are lining up in our generation interconnection queue. That's the line that generating resources sort of get into to be electrically studied and analyzed to find their way onto the power system. We are not the only U.S. power grid or grid worldwide that is experiencing this. This energy transition is certainly a global transition as we see more and more renewable intermittent resources trying to find their way onto the system. And it's not sort of PJM's policy calls that are creating that dynamic. In fact, the transition is a reality for us because of a combination of consumer preference, state policies, federal policies, et cetera, that are creating these opportunities for renewable resources to find their way onto the system. We deal in what is. So what is if you look at the next page, actually, figure 6, and then figure 7 is the Pennsylvania breakdown. What is for us is that we have a number of renewable resources, combination of solar, wind, and storage trying to find their way onto the system. In fact, 97% roughly, 97% of the resources trying to find their way onto the system are renewable resources and batteries. As you can see, you know, we've got an amount that is trying to find their way onto the system that is, you know, far over our peak demand. So, you know, in many ways, this is really good news, right? In order to ensure adequate supply, we want the watts. So this is good news that we've got a number of resources that want to find their way on to the system. Where things get a little bit challenging, and now we'll talk about reliability. And by the way, you know, PJM embraces the transition. We embrace our positioning in the transition. We have advanced a 5-year strategy, one of which is to try and facilitate the policies of our states. We have taken a number of actions, including, I'll get into sort of interconnection process reform to try and expedite, you know, resources finding their way onto the system. We've certainly sort of embraced where we're positioned on the transition and are trying to help facilitate this transition to the best of our ability, not based on, again, our policy preferences, based upon, you know, effectively the policies that are creating this dynamic where statistically we have 252,665 megawatts of resources trying to find their way onto the system. But we have some reliability concerns. And again, these reliability concerns are not exclusive to PJM. In fact, just about every grid operator globally is dealing with these reliability concerns. And in fact, in PJM, we have more time to analyze what others are doing and actually try and find competent solutions to some of these concerns, reliability concerns that we have. The diagram isn't in your slide presentation, but the North American Electric Reliability Corporation, they recently released what's called their summer assessment. And when you look at that summer assessment, they've got a map that very clearly shows that 2/3 of the country is at risk of shedding load this summer. What does shedding load mean? It means turning consumers off so that the rest of the system can maintain functionality. It's effectively what happened in Winter Storm Elliott, or excuse me, in Winter Storm Uri in Texas, if you heard those stories. PJM is not one of those hotspots. This summer, we've put out a series of assessments. You know, certainly we are concerned about reliability later on into the decade. But as we sit here today, we are positioned well. And we affirm that. We believe that we are positioned well as we sit here today. We have enough resources. We have a robust transmission system. We've got time, but we don't have time to waste. And because of what we see in our generation interconnection queue, we feel the need to evolve, and that's exactly what we're trying to do today. We do have our concerns, though. And while we embrace this transition, it does present certain reliability concerns. One of our primary concerns as we sit here today, and really our concerns are threefold. Just stay with me for just a second. We're actually gonna talk about what's on page 12 of the testimony. We've actually got three reliability concerns going forward. Okay, and we break these down into sort of the immediate, the near-term concern, and the upcoming concern. Now, the immediate concern relates to generator performance. Again, we have enough resources today. We have enough resources with a term that I'm going to use, which we're not going to spend a lot of time on, we have enough resources with essential reliability services. You may hear that term as we progress through this decade. What does that mean? It's a term that's actually created by the North American Electric Reliability Corporation. It includes terminology that is physics and grid engineering oriented. These are terms like flexibility, like ramp. These are items that certainly an engineer can come in and speak to you about, but I think what's essential to know about these essential reliability services is that currently they can only be supplied by what are called thermal resources. Thermal resources are nuclear, coal, and gas resources. We currently do not have a technology that can displace or replace those thermal resources and provide those same essential reliability services. Keep that in mind, park that, okay? We have quite a few thermal resources on the system today. That's why if you look at the upcoming concern, we have a reliability concern. It's deeper into the future about not having enough of these essential reliability services, which our thermal resources currently provide. Now, that technology is currently under development, I would say, that technology to replace these thermal resources. But we haven't seen it commercially deployed yet, and we need to see it commercially deployed at scale. You know, effectively, a number of grids are sort of waiting for this technology. Now, the Inflation Reduction Act that was passed by the federal government, it does try and incent some of those technologies. I just listened to some U.S. Senate testimony that said that some of these sort of newer nuclear technologies are the first commercial deployments probably later in this decade. But it's not near term. It's not tomorrow. So as we are transitioning here to a different grid, we have to be mindful that the grid, the engineering of the grid, needs those essential reliability services. But again, PJM, we're well situated today. We're calling it an upcoming concern, a later on concern, but let's park that. We still need that. There's the immediate concern, and then we're going to spend a lot of time on the sort of near-term concern, the middle concern here in this diagram. The immediate concern relates to this past winter and Winter Storm Elliott, and specifically generator performance in Winter Storm Elliott. Again, we have adequate supply today. We have a healthy reserve margin today. But what happened in Winter Storm Elliott was that we were unable to secure the generator performance that we would hope for in a crunch like we experienced in Winter Storm Elliott. In fact, 46,000 megawatts of resources, which is a significant amount of resources, failed to perform at one particular point in time during Winter Storm Elliott. And most of those resources gave us, actually 92% of those resources, gave us less than 1 hour or zero time to tell us that they were not going to be able to perform. We're tackling this. This is an issue that we're tackling today, this concept of trying to support generator performance. We are tackling it through a few different mechanisms, one of them being something very markets-focused. But that is an immediate concern that we are going to tackle today. I'm going to spend the most time talking about this concept of ensuring resource adequacy. It'll take maybe 5-10 more minutes. This concept of ensuring resource adequacy. We put out a paper recently. We call it affectionately the 4R paper. It's one of a series of papers that we have advanced regarding the energy transition. So we've got a series of papers that we're calling Energy Transition in PJM. If we're going to go through this transition, we need to study it. And one of these analyses that we put out, it's called Resource Retirements, Replacements, and Risk, effectively listed out, and let's move on to page 7, actually, or move around to page 7. I've been moving you back and forth and back and forth. But let's turn to page 7. The four conclusions that are listed there, those are the conclusions of this paper, and I'll summarize them orally for you. So we talked about fundamentals of supply and demand. Okay, let's talk about demand. Demand has been relatively flat in the PJM footprint for some time now. we expect demand to increase through this decade. We expect demand to increase for a couple of reasons. One is the concept of electrification, seeing electrification, especially of the automotive industry. The second is we have experienced a real proliferation of data centers in the footprint. These are huge consumers of power. And so both of those things combined lead to, we believe, what will be an increased amount of demand as we progress through the decade. At the same time, now let's talk about supply. At the same time, we are seeing a lot of supply leave the system or scheduled to leave the system. And scheduled to leave the system primarily due to policy preferences. And so we have some policies in the PJM footprint that are effectively going to push some of our thermal resources out of the supply stack, out of our supply collective, especially by 2030, we're going to see a significant number of retirements based upon primarily policy preferences, some economic preferences. At the same time, we are not seeing replacement generation find their way onto the system at the same rate as we are seeing these departures. So if you just do some very simple sort of back of the envelope macro econ, you've got demand increasing, you have supply decreasing. That will lead to a real reduction in PJM's reserve margin, which could lead to, we're not saying it's definitive, which could lead to some reliability issues, especially later on in this decade. So this is a reliability concern that we are being, you know, somewhat vocal about because of, you know, the concern around eventually the potential of not having enough watts to supply our footprint. Now, to the industry's credit, you know, we have managed a transition before. We have managed a transition from coal to gas pretty successfully. The combination of the shale revolution and what's called the MATS rule from 2011, the mercury and air toxic standard rule that was issued in December of 2011, has really sort of facilitated this transition from coal to gas. This one's a little bit different, though, because coal to gas, coal and gas have very similar sort of operating parameters when you think about sort of their thermal properties. You know, this is a bit different. These are smaller resources in nature, and they're intermittent in nature, and they don't have those same essential reliability services. So PJM has sort of, you know, recognized that we are trying to move faster. We need to move faster to get these resources onto the system. If you take a look at Figure 9, what you're going to see there is our generation interconnection queue, statistics related to our generation interconnection queue. And what you'll see is that, generally speaking, the queue remained pretty static through 2018. In 2019, we saw a significant increase in the number of projects trying to find their way into the queue. And then in 2020, another significant increase. So what we did was we said, all right, this is clearly trending to a place where we need to try and evolve our queue process to try and bring these resources on quicker. And so we had a number of stakeholder meetings that, in fact, 21 stakeholder meetings. We began in October of 2020, had 21 stakeholder meetings, submitted a proposal to the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, which is effectively interconnection queue reform. And we're trying to reform the process in full. That proposal was approved by the FERC on November 29th of 2022. So the transition is in effect, effectively. So we are starting our transition to this new queue right now. We expect to process interconnection applications cumulatively represent about 260,000 megawatts worth of resources over the next 3 years. So we are going to be studying and pushing quite a bit of power through the queue, significant amount of power through the queue. Currently, there are about 44,000 megawatts of projects that have come through the study process. Nothing left to do with PJM. By the end of this year, we expect it to be about 62,000 megawatts of resources. But here's the issue with this. So recall that I said that, you know, we've got a lot of supply leaving the system, but we don't have a lot of supply coming onto the system. The rate historically of resources, renewable resources, finding their way to the system has actually been pretty low, even, you know, just based on the sheer volume of resources in the queue. But the concern is what I just referenced, that 44,000 megawatts of resources that have found their way through the queue, 62,000 by the end of this year. These resources are not commercially deploying, okay? They're not actually putting steel in the ground to generate power. So we are very concerned about the rate of success in which these resources are finding their way onto the system. In 2022, there were only 2,000 megawatts of projects built, of which only 700 megawatts were renewables, when there were over 30,000 megawatts of generation with signed ISAs. These are interconnection services agreements. In 2023 so far, only about 300 megawatts have been built. Okay. Now, we talked to developers. Developers aren't obligated to tell us why they're not putting steel in the ground, but there are certainly a number of external variables that are challenging the ability for renewable resources to find their way onto the system. This includes a lot of local opposition, cost of capital, developer financing challenges. Supply chain is a really big issue right now in the renewable development space. Siting and permitting, and also market signals. I mean, we have to also do our part to try and ensure that these resources find their way onto the system. But as we sit here right now, look, if you just do a macro analysis of PJM, use that word macro too many times, I'll stop. But if you just look at PJM right now, we've got a ton of supply today. We've got a ton of supply trying to find their way onto the system. But there may be a year here where there's a breaking point, because we've got a lot of policy pushing resources off the system. And if we're only going to get this little amount of resources that commercially put steel in the ground, we are going to find ourselves conceivably into a reliability challenge. So we're being vocal about this, and we're trying to do something about it. On the commercial development side, though, PJM sort of divorced from that. We can make sure that our processes are updated to meet the transition, but, you know, we are concerned about, again, the commercial development of this. Last few points. So page 12 lists out a initiative that we have advanced at PJM. We call it Ensuring a Reliable Energy Transition. We list our concerns here, but we also, if you visit the PJM website, it's front and center, Ensuring a Reliable Energy Transition. You'll see that in the planning, markets, and operations space that we are advancing. It's approximately 16 or so efforts to try and evolve our processes to meet the needs of this energy transition. So we are being very active in this space, combination of trying to ensure reliability as well as keep costs low for consumers, all dealing in this, many of which dealing in these sort of supply-demand dynamics that I've just discussed today. So PJM is certainly not sitting on its hands on this. We want to try and be solution seekers to the transition. It does us no good to come and say we've got problems, and for us to not do our part. Also in the testimony on page 11 are some suggestions for policymakers, and policymakers broadly, not just policymakers for the state of Pennsylvania. You know, these are actually, you know, frankly, plagiarized from some testimony that my boss did at the U.S. Senate a couple weeks ago. So some items that have been listed here, including in any policy, energy policy that's adopted, what are the reliability impacts going to be of this policy? And making sure that there are continuous check-ins on reliability as the policy is being advanced. We have tried to work with our policymakers on this concept of, you know, ensuring that legislation takes reliability into account. We've done it with some success. But I think we're being a little more vocal to say, please, when you're advancing energy policy, reliability and cost are very important for consumers. So, you know, please use us as a resource. We're happy to be a resource. You know, even the some of the agencies that we work with in the federal government have also recognized their concerns around reliability, Department of Energy, for instance. So we are more than happy to serve as a resource to try and, again, study at the front end and then continuously study reliability as policy is being implemented, just to make sure that, you know, we don't have this situation where the policy has no off-ramp or no outs in the event that reliability is challenged, and that, you know, as policymakers, you know what is happening with the policies that you are trying to advance. There's a nugget in here about balancing permitting reform. So I certainly think that permitting reform is something that the federal government is trying to tackle. We are becoming increasingly more dependent on natural gas. We will continue to need pipelines sited to meet our reliability needs. So EPA's greenhouse gas proposal calls for a huge increase in the co-firing of natural gas or hydrogen or sequestration of carbon dioxide. And so if that rule stands, you know, we are going to need effectively a new transportation network for hydrogen and transportation. And so trying to ensure sort of, you know, again, balanced permitting reform, which respects the jurisdiction of state and local governments at the same time, moves things somewhat, you know, maybe in a little more expedited fashion, is something that I think, again, the federal government is looking into and we're espousing to policymakers generally. The last item, the last bullet there, you know, the electric grid is one of our most important infrastructure assets. It is critical to the economy, health, and security of all Americans. We need to give protection and enhancement of the grid, you know, a level of focus in the same way that we give to our environmental goals. They're certainly different, and they certainly impact health, human safety, economies differently. And again, PJM has embraced that we are in this transition, has embraced that our policymakers are trying to effectuate change on the climate side. If we can just consider grid impacts as well, I think we will find ourselves hopefully through this transition. Again, PJM, as we sit here today, we're in a good place. We've got work to do, and we're being, you know, again, trying to combination of being vocal about our concerns, but also trying to seek solutions as well. So I thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm sorry I was all over the map on this within my testimony, but hopefully it was somewhat helpful to how you all are evaluating your energy policy priorities.
We appreciate your testimony. Let's get right into the questions. You talked about your the queue in what you presented to FERC that was approved relative to alleviate the backlog on the queue. That's one thing we hear as policymakers, specifically surrounding renewables, honestly, solar especially, about development. With the new approval of that recommendation, once you're caught up, what's the time frame on something from start to finish, approximate time when making that request?
Chairman, that's a good question. First thing I'll say is, again, we are effectively transitioning to a new process where instead of sort of first in line, a first in line dynamic, we have a first ready dynamic. And what that means is you have shown the ability to have your finances in order and you have site control, okay? I don't have a definitive start to finish, here's the amount of time that a resource will enter the queue and find their way out. Certainly it will be sooner than the current framework that we have in place. I'm hesitant to give you a definitive timeline just because, you know, we are currently transitioning. We're clearing the backlog right now. Then we're going to be implementing this new process. And so it will certainly be shorter, but again, we will process a number of interconnection queue requests over this next few years, roughly 257,000 megawatts over the next 3 years to clear this backlog. And then I do think that the timeframes for when a resource enters will certainly be shorter. I can speak to my planners to see if I can get a more firmed up answer for you.
I'm happy to hear you mention from a scoring perspective on getting onto the grid that it's not first one. It's, you know, if you're ready, you're ready. Yep. I mean, that's good news to hear. I've always been a proponent of an all-everything energy portfolio as a rank-and-file member, now as a chairman especially. You know, I want to continue to be an exporter of energy in Pennsylvania. I think that's important to the grid, important to reliability, and important to the costs to our residents and ratepayers. From the perspective of as we continue to lose that base load generation, coal being offline here within the next 5 or 6 years in Pennsylvania, the nukes have rebounded, from the market perspective, which we're obviously happy to hear about from that perspective. But that whole everything energy portfolio, that has to go into the mix from our perspective as policymakers, and as you analyze and are putting forth the efforts. From your testimony, that's the same for you, correct?
That is correct. Again, we need the physical properties that thermal resources provide. Nuclear, coal, gas provide certain essential reliability services. Sorry to continue to use the phrase, but essential reliability services that, as we sit here today, there's not a technology that can be deployed at scale that replaces those physical properties that those resources can provide.
I like the opening of your testimony because it's a line I've always used, similar to the line, paraphrase. But, you know, there's a level of expectation when people flip the switch. The lights are coming on. When people turn the knob, the water's coming out. So I got a little smile out of me when you said that. Chairman Marshall, thank you. We know you were delayed on the turnpike, but we're glad you made it. Any questions from you, Mr. Chairman?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have so many. I'm going to start with just one or two and then defer to other members. But I also smiled when the comment came on about flicking the switch. And another comment that Chairman Matzie makes often is it's always sunny in Beaver County. So with that, and you mentioned the queue, as did the chairman, we have solar arrays that are built in Beaver County and probably, if not already online, close to being productive. Yet we have others that are in the queue and have been for up to and beyond 2 years. So when you said you really can't tell how long that wait is, I mean, to me, I think 30 days is a great wait. 2 years is too long. And when you say that you have so many prospective developers and you want them to be, why isn't steel in the ground? I think it's steel's not in the ground because they're in the queue. So they need to be, their applications need to be reviewed quickly so that steel can get in the ground. Hopefully Pennsylvania steel gets in the ground to put these grids up and the panels up and to get producing. And like Chairman Matzie, we rely on base load and a broad portfolio that must include nuclear, gas, and hopefully coal. The thermal that you had mentioned, we certainly rely on that. We need that. But we also have the renewables that have the ability to assist on good days, and we want them to be processed relatively quickly. You had also mentioned about things look good, and your mission may not be critical, but I think last Christmas it was very critical. We need to make sure that we don't have rolling blackouts or brownouts this summer or this coming winter when the need is high. So I guess really I'm not looking for answers today, but this committee needs to continue to look to make sure that we can have a reliable grid at PJM our residents deserve that, and our consumers benefit when we're exporting energy. So I think that's all I have right now, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Questions from members? Representative Mahaffey. First of all, welcome back to the committee. So I want to formally welcome you back to the committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is a pleasure to be on this committee, and you know how much I love it. Thank you for your testimony. And I just want to say thank you for sounding the alarm, because we do have a problem. We have a major problem. And people need to wake up around here and figure this out real quick. Because 2018, correct me if I'm wrong, Chairman Matzey, yourself, Chairman Marshall, and a whole group of us got together and sounded this alarm. And you know what happened in 5 years? Another plant's going to close. Another baseload power plant's going to close, Homer City. And at that time, it was all about nuclear power. You, as PJM, maybe not you specifically, said, if we lose TMI, we'll be okay. Wrong answer. We're not okay. This grid, there is a major malfunction here right now, and we need to get back. The West Coast sees and has and is implementing SMRs at this point in time. I know that technology is out there a little bit further than most people want. The small modular reactors are, and they're being right here in PA studied by Westinghouse. So why in the world are we not moving forward? And you asked, you said, let us be a resource. We are not experts. We are not. People come to us and say, hey, we need to do this or that. You should be coming to us and saying, you need to do this, because this is what needs to be done. It's great to have solar and wind, but it is not baseload power. Now, my concern is, and my first question to you is, this past Christmas, which they brought up, the chairman brought up, how close were we to having a blackout or a brownout?
Yeah, so, Representative, we still had a few steps to take before we would have shed load. So we were at a particular level where certainly we were concerned. We didn't institute, you know, what's called voltage control, which would have been a precursor to what would have been, we'll call it controlled outages, meaning we would ask that particular lines effectively not find themselves in operation, which would shed a particular amount of load, and we would rotate those in a rotating fashion. We didn't get there. We didn't get there with voltage control either. But certainly, and to the chairman's point as well, that was, in our eyes, a generator performance issue. We have to ensure generator performance. So the resources that we have on the system today, they are, you know, effectively receiving payments to perform. They need to perform.
So generator performance comes from the capacity market, correct?
Well, generator performance, there is a market structure that is affixed to effectively asking resources to be available
right
when we call on them.
But that's through when you enter the capacity market and that generator says, I am going to produce X amount of megawatts for your system, that is in place, correct?
That is correct.
Okay. Where are we at with the capacity market?
Yeah, the capacity market, we are currently analyzing reforms to the capacity market. And certainly Winter Storm Elliott and the generator performance that we saw is a component of how we view reform. So we need to certainly look at the penalty structure that's in place. So those generators that failed to perform were assessed, a certain level of penalties. Those penalties, find their way to, those generators that did in fact perform. We are analyzing that structure today to see if certain market changes, including we're analyzing whether or not we should be boots on the ground conducting inspections of generating units, which is not something that we have traditionally done, to ensure winter performance and availability.
So when was the last capacity market bid?
So there is a capacity market that was run earlier this year, and the current slate of capacity auctions have been delayed, so we can try and pursue these reforms and submit them to the FERC.
Are you in a capacity market right now, or is that completely defunct as far as, because it happens every year for a three-year period. Are we in our last year, is that correct, or is that in the capacity market that you actually have a bid process in place for?
Yeah, we have one in place right now.
Okay. Thank you for that. Now, two letters you've received from the Governor Shapiro. One, of course, we talked about interconnection earlier with the chairman and his concerns of why that's not getting done. And the time frame, as Chairman Marshall said, 2 years is not acceptable. The other one was a letter concerned about the grid and how things are, how you're pursuing and what you're doing to make sure that we don't have a Texas and that we don't have what happened last Christmas. And here's my point. Back in 2018, they weren't concerned, and they said, oh, if we lose 900 megawatt system, we'll be okay. We're not okay. The point I'm making is gas, and I'm for all energy. I have no problem with it. I don't care if it's solar. I don't care if it's wind. I don't care if it's gas. I don't care if it's coal, whatever. Whatever, when I flip the light switch, my lights come on, is what I'm for. The point I'm making is there is only two kinds of baseload power, and that is nuclear power because of the fuel source that they have, and number two is coal, okay? Gas is on demand, but gas is very finicky. And you know as well as I do what happened in Texas and what happened last year here in Pennsylvania. Gas got a little finicky because it got really, really cold. The point I'm making is that's really not a baseload power. It's a demand. It's on demand. So they're receiving it. They're receiving it. But in this state, we have to send that fuel source to home heating fuel first before it comes to generation. Do you feel that that was a problem when this weather became and they weren't receiving the amount of gas they needed to generate electricity?
Yeah, of the gas outages, Representative, 70% were issues within the fence line of the plant. So 70% of the outages were attributable to, frankly, weatherization. Stuff broke in cold weather situations. So in particular, that situation. So the majority is really a weatherization, winterization issue within the plant fence line. And then the remaining 30%, you could break down between a combination of things, frozen wellheads, something that we saw. Mm-hmm. We saw the production of Marcellus and Utica shale decrease pretty substantially over that period, as well as freeze-offs in the delivery system, as well as some contractual issues. So it's a series of items in the sort of 30% bucket.
Yeah, see, and that's my concern. We have a problem with redundancy and how we have to handle that. If there's breakdowns, they should be able to fix that. Where there's things that go on, and what I learned in the nuke business is that we have had and put in place different things as government officials to make sure these problems don't happen again, i.e. TMI, i.e. Chernobyl, i.e. Fukushima. And those are the things that, maybe we have to start looking at other plants and saying, okay, what's your redundancy plan when it gets this cold and what are the problems that you had and where are we going? I appreciate your time. I appreciate the chairman indulging me on these questions. I can ask 1,000 more of them. Of course, you know that, Mr. Chairman. But I'm here to listen to you. If you want to bring these things forward, I'm in because I like this stuff. I've been involved in this stuff for quite a few years, and it is not easy to understand.
Sure.
I think we all can understand that. But if you want to bring it forth and we want to have a full energy talk about what we need, how we want to go forward, we need to do it now, not 5 years from now. We can't wait another 5 years. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Tom. I think I said in 2018 that I don't think it was a stretch to say we probably should have a special session on energy, and I still kind of sort of believe that.
Representative Steele. Thank you, Chair. And thank you for your testimony. It was really, really good and informative. I appreciate the policy recommendations that you included, and I look forward to reading those. I'm glad to hear that PJM is focused on responsibly but expeditiously moving along the transition. That's great to hear. It seems to me that we need to do three things urgently. Number one, we need to do whatever we can to expedite MSRs. Two, we need to do whatever we can to drive domestic production of solar components. There's a manufacturer coming into my district that is going to be doing that. It's very exciting. And then three, given the current key role that thermals play, we need to ensure that we are doing that in as clean a way as possible. So we need to be looking at that as well. My question is, you mentioned that were two things that were going to drive significant increase in the near future. One was electrification, including EVs. Two is the data centers. Are those related to cryptocurrency?
Yeah, Representative, I honestly don't know the answer to that. The largest contingency of data center concentration in the country is actually located in Loudoun County, Virginia, which was where Virginia is also part of the PJM footprint. The statistic that we have consistently heard about Loudoun County, which I can't recall the exact stat, but it relates to the amount of internet traffic that flows through just that particular area. I have not heard anything about these data centers being driven by crypto mining. I have not heard that. I've heard it primarily just because of the concentration being in really a couple places, Loudoun County and Columbus, Ohio, actually, because of existing, you know, when one data center decides to locate, creates sort of this this infrastructure opportunity where others also then start gravitating towards the same location. And thus far, it's all been about internet traffic, is what I've heard. I have not heard that they're for crypto mining.
If I could jump in for a second, in conversations I had with a potential developer for a data center in my district, that was the first question I asked. And they said no, obviously, from the perspective of the internet traffic is the goal of the data centers. And the interesting component about how much electricity is needed, it's also my understanding that Virginia, while not, I don't believe it's a formal moratorium, they're like saying we don't want any more data centers because it's too much of a stress on their grid system. So that's from what I understand based on recent conversations.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that we should probably consider here in Pennsylvania. If it's really going to spike demand too quickly, faster than we can handle, then perhaps we need to set a limit here as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. You had talked about policy pushing the decommissioning of thermal power as well as pushing the renewables. And then you talked about the onboarding being slower than some might hope. That leads to reliability problems. So we here in Pennsylvania have largely been blessed with a solid energy system. It's been great, except for a storm or something where we've been out for a week or two or whatever. My question is, can you talk to us about the impacts of what would happen, what needs to be contemplated in terms of if there are reliability problems in a community and a state?
Yeah, Representative, if there are reliability problems, it sort of changes the complexion of any local economy. So, you know, we have a very diverse footprint. We have cities in our footprint that are, you know, some of the largest urban centers in the United States of America. So a lack of reliability would certainly challenge just the day-to-day operations of those urban centers. I'm from the state of Ohio, born and raised. Please don't punish me for that. Large manufacturing base. And used to work for an auto manufacturer, as I said. And so when the power goes out, you know, you cannot, that line will not function. That line doesn't function, you know, people lose their jobs, communities are supporting are supported by, you know, the factory, you know, effectively find themselves in a challenging situation, not to mention some of the sort of more health and human services items related to just not having power. I mean, we have all lived through, you know, not necessarily at the bulk system level, but at the distribution level, we've all lived through, you know, a day with your power out or a couple days with your power out. And, you know, some of those issues related to, you know, does the local healthcare facility have power? What does that mean for the ability to provide healthcare? Is there healthcare being provided in someone's home, right? In-home health. What happens to your food? These are all sort of, you know, again, part of the entire, I would say, health and human services framework, all of which sort of finds their way up to making sure that we have a reliable power grid.
Thank you. I think many of us have been township supervisors or local officials of some sort, and we are involved with the EMS and trying to figure out what happens in these circumstances. You had mentioned that we're looking at possible lack of supply towards the end of the decade, and then you talked about how the time it takes to onboard some of these issues. It could take a while, and we may be having these problems more than we wish if this is not done correctly. It seems to me, I think, for my part, I think we need to be very careful with how we transition, because we don't want to get in that situation where, you know, by the end of the decade, just 7 short years away, we're having this problem.
Yeah, it's a great comment. And, you know, maybe a couple comments from me just to, Chairman Marshall, Representative Mahaffey, and also you, Representative, you know, about the queue. So, again, and, you know, I hope this is not meant to be sort of a narrative, right? This is, you know, when we recognized, again, if you take a look at Figure 9, when we recognized that the queue was sort of being overwhelmed with these smaller, more intermittent resources, you know, we took measures to try and change how we do things to a different framework, because just think about it from our perspective. You know, you've got these large, centralized, multi-hundred megawatt resources that we used to study in the queue. And that changed. We don't have those resources in the queue anymore. We don't have the baseload power resources in the queue anymore. We've got a few uprates. That's of some natural gas units. It's all we've got. Again, 97% solar, wind, storage. So we had to change how we do things, and we did it in a pretty short time frame. Getting something done, you know, I'm sure that you all, you know, have your own sort of challenges in getting legislation through a committee and then through, you know, eventually passed by your body and then signed by the governor. The PJM stakeholder process might be like that, you know, with an exponent of 10. We have 1,000-plus members, and we were able to get through this queue reform, you know, 4-point-something out of 5.0 voting done. So even the developers were on board with our solution, Chairman. And so we submitted that to the FERC. They take their time. They take their time. Certainly the FERC takes their time. And the net result is, you know, queue reform that will push these resources through quicker, and the clearing of a backlog that is 250-something thousand megawatts over the next 3 years. Think about the next 3 years. You know, I blinked, and, you know, from the second the ball dropped and the Buckeyes missed their 50-yard field goal to go to the national championship to today, it's the half year's already over, right? And we're studying tons of resources as we exist today. And in 3 years, we will have studied, you know, 250-something thousand megawatts of renewable resources. And so from the queue's perspective, we are evolving, and we will continue to push these studies out. We just need to see this development occur. And so, you know, a suggestion for the panel, and I know Representative Mahaffey does not want me to give these suggestions, but a suggestion for the panel would be, you know, we are trying to talk to commercial developers of renewable resources and say, what's going on? How can we help? Right? But there's only so much we can do. Getting these resources through the queue quicker, that's totally key for us, and that's something that we've got to do. But some of these other things, they're just not in our control. And so maybe trying to sort of dig in with the developers a little bit to say, hey, how can we help? Because, you know, as an all of the above state, you know, we and as PJM is concerned, we're not discriminatory towards resources. We want all the watts, right? We want the current watts. We want the new watts. We're trying to keep the lights on, right? So I think, you know, from that lens, you know, as it relates to the queue, I've now forgotten your question, Representative. But, you know, from that lens, as we look at the queue, you know, I think we have done, you know, as expeditious a job in reforming that process as we can, and we are going to see a lot of renewable resources through that queue. We've got to get the steel in the ground. We've got to get the replacement rate up to match the level of retirements. As far as, you know, there have been some comments around sort of the policy of the state. And I'm reminded of this, you know, very consistently by the competitive generating community in the state of Pennsylvania. Policy of the state, you know, currently is that Pennsylvania has chosen to be a competitive markets-based state. Now, that's where Pennsylvania is positioned today, and it has done, you know, Pennsylvania is, when you think about where Pennsylvania is positioned, you know, in PJM, Pennsylvania is a net exporter to the PJM states writ large. If PJM's the largest grid and one of the largest players of grid operators in the country, it means that Pennsylvania is one of the most important energy producing states in the nation, in the world. This dynamic of utilizing competitive markets to drive development, to drive costs down for consumers, has served Pennsylvania really, really well. I think it'll continue to serve Pennsylvania really, really well. If Representative Mahaffey was still here, I might tell him, hey, the policy of the state right now, as it exists today, is great policy because it has done quite a bit for the state. Do those markets need to evolve? Absolutely. And that's actually, Representative Mahaffey mentioned the capacity market. We're actually looking to advance reform to the capacity market today. We plan to actually finish up this process in August, get a filing in with the FERC in October, so we can get back to the normal regime of capacity markets. So the policy of the state has served the state very well. Do these things need to evolve? Markets, operations, planning. Absolutely, they need to evolve. As a committee, and the door was opened by Representative Mahaffey, as a committee, you know, I think, you know, some of the items we have listed out here as some potential, you know, opportunities for policymakers, I think is a place to start. But, you know, the ultimate concern is resources pushed off too fast, which Pennsylvania is sort of not in the business of, right? You don't have push out all coal by X date or all, you know, whatever by Y date. You don't have that. You're competitive markets based. And, again, it has served you very well. And so I think, you know, you don't have that, but how do we get resources on quicker, assuming that, Chairman, you know, the work will be done within the queue. Okay, if we assume that, then we assume that the wait time or the lag time in the queue will be significantly different after we clear this backlog. You know, why isn't this development happening, and what can Pennsylvania do to help support that? I think is a great sort of mission.
Well, we appreciate your time today. I think the key takeaway is something we've talked about quite a bit on this committee is reliability. And I think as policymakers, it's important for us to look at, and quite frankly, we're charged with that mission in a representative form of government, to think about everything as it pertains to our baseload generation. What I mean by that is when we were threatened with the demise of the nuclear industry in Pennsylvania, my standard line was, yes, I have to worry about the grid and the megawatts, et cetera, but I also am in the people business. Yep. I got to worry about the community that will be devastated by the loss of family-sustaining jobs and all the small businesses that would be affected by that and by that baseload generation coming offline. So, you know, we have to think about all of that stuff. Yep. And as policymakers, I think it's important for us, and far too often this building especially, but any legislative body is reactive. I want, as the chairman of this committee, to be proactive. So I appreciate the recommendations in your testimony. We look forward to more recommendations. You know, we talked about when Representative Mahaffey asked the questions about the storm, and you mentioned the issue with some of the gas facilities. 70% of the issues happen within the fence. Are there issues we have to do from a perspective of public policy? So those are all things we have to, and to, you know, piggyback on Representative Marshall's point relative to in the queue and still in the ground, et cetera, I'll take an opposite approach sometimes, because I think every one of us at one time or another, regardless of how long you've been in office, there are a lot of idea people that come into our office with big ideas that want money before they start.
Sure.
So you may have the best idea in the world, but guess what? I don't have a brown paper bag with $25 million in to get started for it. So you have to have your ducks in a row. So as I said at the onset, I was pleased to hear that as part of the new process that in scoring those applications, who's ready?
Yep.
And I think that's an important component from a public policy perspective as well, for the reliability of our grid and to ensure that those developments can occur, and they can occur in swift action. So, Chairman Marshall, any final thoughts?
Yes, sir. First, thank you. This is probably the most important hearing we've had. PJM is essential to all of us. And consumer protection is not just our name, it's our mission. So our consumers are protected with reliable base load, with a secure grid, and that's one issue that we didn't discuss, the grid age and security of the grid. And consumers are protected when energy prices are low. So you'll be hearing from us, we'll continue the dialogue. I really value your time today and appreciate you being here.
Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you.
To be honest, we could have probably had a four-hour hearing.
And, you know, could have.
And had a break and an intermission between. I mean, we didn't even get a chance to get into hydrogen and carbon capture and some of the other things. And those are things, obviously, we rely on you as a key stakeholder to answer those questions as we continue to look at that as a public policy perspective in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Your invitation is received. The committee is planning on making a trip at some point in time during this session.
Great.
We want to come down to see the site. I know some of us have had that opportunity, and as I try and explain to folks, it's like being on board the USS Enterprise at times. But if you've been inside a nuclear plant, same thing, very similar. So we plan on, because of such a large turnover and new members on the committee, try to get out there as much as possible to see as much as possible, because I'm a firm believer, walk a mile in my shoes. When you see it, you know, firsthand with your own eyes, you really get a handle and understanding on the massive responsibility, but as well as just the overwhelming experience you get when you walk onto that floor, and I wanted to say showroom, because you know sometimes it seems like a showroom of a trade show because of just the glitz and glamour and the lights, etc. But again, thank you for your testimony. We appreciate you being available to the committee. With that, this meeting is adjourned.